How are you doing, Joe?
I'm doing great. Thank you. First of all, thank you very much for coming on our now annual cruise. We're doing it. We're gonna do another one next year, and I hope everybody's having a good time. You know, when they when we first signed up for this, you know, like, I was like, this blues boy doesn't float, you know. And last year we I got to walk around and meet a lot of you guys. Well, I met everybody. Sorry about that. I just couldn't do that again. How many people on the meet and greet today? 2,600. Wait a minute. And I went and I got to see everybody, and I saw how much fun everybody was having, and I said, well, you know what? It's worth a couple of Dramamine and these funky wristbands to come back and do it again. So I'm glad you guys are here. Very much so. So I should start by admitting something to you all, and anybody who follows me on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter or Snapchat or any of the other various social media options that we have now, I am a bona fide guitar addict. Thank you very much. I have had this addiction since I've been a kid. My father twice ran a guitar shop, and I was just enthralled with music, and I was enthralled with vintage guitars. I loved old guitars. I loved old Fender amps. And as a kid, I would sit there and I'd go through these books and I'd go through these catalogs and these old vintage guitar magazines with these big lists of guitars and prices that I couldn't afford, and would just spend hours and hours and hours in my room going, this is what I want to be around. You know, I don't care how I'm going to be around it, but I know I want to, you know, one of these days I want to touch a 1959 Sunburst Les Paul. One of these days I wanna play through a Tweed Fender amp. I don't know how I was gonna do it. And around 1989, we were called out to do a television show called Into the Night with Rick Dees, which was on ABC. Oh yeah. And I was this little kid involved in a skit with a Barney Fife impersonator and the band Billy Vera and the Beaters. And my dignity aside, I was able to take my first trip to Los Angeles, is where I live now. And I remember going to the guitar shops on Sunset Boulevard. And it would be the Guitar Center, there would have been Albert Molinaro's store called Guitars R Us. There was literally, you could spend the afternoon, it's a shell of itself now, there's only Guitar Center left, but back in those days, you could go and you could basically window shop the whole afternoon, and then you would eat tacos at El Compadre, and for a fat 12-year-old, this was living. And that's where I saw my first Fender, you know, blonde neck Fender Stratocaster from the 50s, the first Tweed amp, the first things that I would, you know, actually touching and playing the guitars that I would see in these books living in upstate New York. And finally, towards the end of the trip, a nice person that was taking us around and helping us out mentioned something. He goes, hey, you know what? If you like this stuff on Sunset Boulevard, you should really go see Norma. And I'm like, Dad, can we drive out and see Norman? And he's like, sure, son. And we took a drive into the valley, and we went to Norm's Rare Guitars. And when I tell you, Norman has always had the best of the best. And it was the first time I met Norman. It was the first time I got to see the best of the best and, you know, look at things that I could only imagine seeing in a book, you know, but they were right next to it, you know. So when the idea came up to talk to Norman about, you know, collecting, that I said, you know, we should share some of these stories, you know, and I think, you know, some of you guys would really get a kick out of them. So without further ado, I give you a legend in the guitar business, Norm Harris from Norm's Rare Guitars.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you for being here, Norm. And, you know, Norm and I have been friends for 25 years or more. And to prove it, Norman kept, you know, I mean, what a fucking ego I had when I was 12. Because I was a nobody. I was this little fat blonde kid running around Southern California with a Telecaster on television with Billy Vera and the Beaters and a radio personality named Rick Dees. But I had 8x10 glossies, and I had such an ego that I felt the need to sign one for the shop. Can we see that slide, please? Oh, did they? Can you go back? There it is. What an ego on that boy. So, about 3 years ago, Norm brings it out, and I couldn't believe it, that you kept it all these years. You may have saw something in me that I didn't even realize, but thank you for keeping that. You know, it's a very cool piece of memorabilia.
Well, I did see it, and when Phil first came in and he started picking up some guitars to play, I was going, this kid's a freak. I mean, you know, and he played like crazy. And he loved his old stuff that, you know, young kids just didn't get it, you know. He came in and he was like, can I see this? Can I play this? And can I touch this? And I loved it, you know, because it kind of showed me where the future is going to be. And I just would like to say one thing. I've known Joe for many years, and I'm so proud of him because besides being one of the greatest players, he's also one of the greatest guys.
You know, some people that know me very well and knew me when I was 12 and know me now, and I'm almost 40 years old, I really haven't matured or changed at all from that point. The same dude. So Norman,
that's what I love about
you. Yeah, exactly. So Norman, you have a book that you wrote, and you were nice enough to ask me to write the foreword along with Richie Sambora. What's it called?
It's called Confessions of a Vintage Guitar Dealer.
And tell me some, you know, a few things about what's in the book. You know, it's not just a bunch of pictures of guitars. It's more of the backstory of how you found things and you know, the legendary instruments you've had over the years.
Well, you know, the first book I did was this one over here. And Tom Petty did the foreword. And I wrote some of the stories, and then I went, you know, people don't really want to hear this crap. And I took all the stories out, and there was a little bit of text. It was more just pictures of guitars. Going out, and I used to get the LA Times at 5 in the morning. I would follow the trucks as they left the yard to go drop off the papers at the first stop. Then I would start calling people up at like 5:45 in the morning, and you know, a lot of them weren't too happy, you know. But I would tell a white lie and say, I'm going to work today and I have some cash in my pocket, I'd love to come over and buy your guitar. And about 75% of them let me come through, and about 25% was like. So, but I was relentless, and people that have the bug, such as Joe over here, he's relentless too. Now his mom is sitting over here, Deborah, and she said to me the other day, listen, can you, yeah, great parents, Len and Deborah over there, and and his mom said, listen, can you help Joe, I mean, you know, can you get him to stop buying guitars? So I said, yeah, I have both my fingers crossed, sorry.
She's like, I keep telling him, you need a 401k. Not everybody needs a Les Paul.
So, one of the great things about collecting in general, and all of this, is the story. You know, a guitar is a guitar. Now, you're looking at a 59 Les Paul Standard and a...
Joe Bonamassa.
Les Paul. From Epiphone. Now, one is a $300,000 guitar, and one is a $500 guitar. And the thing is, once you get... They all sound pretty much within the same 10%, but it's the story and the soul and the history that has been you know, ingrained in these old things that kind of gets us collectors addicted, you know? And we figured a good thing to start with is, like, at the very beginning, we can go to the next slide. These early Martin guitars, especially this one here. Now, this is, I believe, out of your collection. And what are we looking at here?
It's a 1928 00045. Now, you know, Martin Guitars, it's the oldest American company. They've been around since 1833. And some of the very earliest guitars are very historical, but they didn't have the actual models perfected until like the 30s and 40s. Those guitars are much more playable. So some of the really early ones are valuable and have a lot of history to them, but once they got to that point, they became very usable. So a lot of these fancy ones that had the mother of pearl trim, those were given to cowboy stars and, you know, it was wealthy people. And also 1928, you know, you're talking Depression and all that, people didn't have the money to spend for the extra fancy trim and all the better woods and all that kind of stuff. And I also would like to just say, too, that we can blame the Beatles for a lot of this stuff. Because in 1964, when the Beatles became very big, every kid in the world wanted to have a guitar. Now, whether it was to get the girls or whether it was to be a great guitar player, the demand went through the roof. And people had to have guitars. So they started using inferior woods, you know, the tone woods that they used for guitars. Sometimes they were 50 or 100 years old before they ever became a guitar. And now they had all this demand, so they had to start lessening their, you know, the quality of the woods. You know, they couldn't kind of go for the best of the best because they had to keep making more guitars. And they were pulling people in off the streets to try to teach them how to build a guitar because they had so much demand, they couldn't keep up with it.
And, you know, people also needed things like chairs and kitchen tables, you know, not just guitars. Although, my house...
You eat off of a guitar.
I sit on an amp and eat it, you know, my kitchen table is a guitar, so I think there's nothing wrong with it. Let's go to the next slide. Now, this is the big brother. Now, if you were looking at, talking about the equivalent, the acoustic guitar equivalent of a Stradivarius violin, this is probably what we're looking
this
at.
This is it. There were, I believe there were 91 of them made, and mostly the cowboy stars. Gene Autry had one. I mean, they were just, you know, they were meant for very successful entertainers. Not a lot of them around. It's like the Flying V. They made almost the same exact amount.
Yeah, and you know, the first time I heard a D45 or any big body Martin, my father played me Crosby, Stills, and Nash, Sweet Judy Blue Eyes, which I still think is one of the high water marks of acoustic guitar sound. I always try to get that sound. Fail most of the times, but I always try to get that sound. And you know, Neil Young used a D45. Steven Stills used a D45, and it was always like this so such a cool guitar associated with that kind of Laurel Canyon folk, you know, rock scene. And the reason why they're so valuable is because of that, and because of how few there were made. You know, not that many.
It's always supply and demand. If the demand exceeds the supply, if there were 10,000 of something made and a million people want it, that's what drives the prices up. If there's one of something and it's kind of weird and nobody wants it, it keeps the price down low.
Right. Let's go to the next slide, if you don't mind. Now, these are called D'Angelicos. Now, the Italians are good for making pasta sauce. We can shred Satriani, Vi, Bonamassa. And we're damn good at making arch tops, like this D'Angelico. Now this is what, a New Yorker?
That is an XL, and it's, what was very unusual about it, it's a 16-inch body. And this guitar I recently acquired, I bought a big collection of guitars from somebody I sold guitars to 25 or 30 years ago. And he bought them for, at the time, what seemed to be an enormous amount of money, and he sold them for a much more enormous amount of money to me back. Wasn't too bright, but you know, I sold them, and once again I bought them. And this particular guitar, I just sold to Eric Clapton. And I just want to say one thing. I don't know if you guys were out at the pool this morning and saw Josh Smith. Now, that guy is my secret weapon. That guy is so good, that I get him to do videos with my guitars. And when Joe comes in, I do the same thing. I pester Joe, and he does some too. But he did a video with this guitar, and I sent it off to Eric, and the guitar was sold. So now it's in the proud hands of Eric Clapton.
That's good. By the way, Josh Smith, I mean, not to single him out, but Josh Smith is a good friend of mine, and one of the very few guitar players, when I sit on stage with him, we do it very often, that fear is the feeling I have. He is so damn good, and we're so lucky to have him. So if you see him coming around your town, go see him.
He's the man. He's after Josh Smith.
Let's go to the next slide. Now this is a Stromberg. Now these were made for jazz. Okay, these were made to cut through orchestras. So, you know, the Martin is a bigger sound. It's more pleasing to the ear, especially if you're sitting around a campfire or just playing in your house or playing with a band. These guitars, like the Stromberg and the D'Angelico, the one that we just looked before, the Excel, these were made to cut through an orchestra when amplification basically didn't exist.
Right. The guitar players are basically playing rhythm behind all these big bands with loads of horns and drums and everything else. And this is pre-amplification days, so they had to develop some guitars that are going to cut to the back of the room. Now, the guitars in the round holes, the sound kind of disperses immediately. So it's loud to the player. But the guitars with these F holes, they shoot basically to the back of the room, and they cut through better than the round hole guitars.
Hence, the reign of terror begins, where the guitar must be the loudest thing in the band.
Well, you know, Joe, like Christopher Guest said, he said, you know, we're great because we play really loud. This is Spinal Tap. He said, you know those jazz players, they play so low you just got to take their word for it.
Let's go to the next slide. Now these are Hawaiian guitars. Now there was a huge craze in, I would say, the 30s, 40s, even into the 50s, Hawaiian music. Everybody wanted a hula skirt, and they wanted to go to Honolulu on vacation. I can tell you this now. I've been in Honolulu. I've played in Honolulu. I don't want to go back to Honolulu. I hear it was nice in the 50s. But no, these guitars were really, really designed for a sound that wasn't meant for blues, but the blues guys kind of take, you know,
It was a way for them to kind of cut through, and they were kind of looking for sort of a trashy sound that kind of, you know, it wasn't the music of the wealthy. So they needed something to get their sound out, and they went to a lot of these resonator guitars. Now this guitar has actually three resonators, like these round metal cones inside, and it projects the sound out. And they made a single resonator as well. And they were very popular before the electric guitar.
Yes.
And still a lot of the older blues guys still use them. People like the sound of Fender.
People like Sun House, Johnny Winter, one of my favorites, Chris Whitley, made a lot of great music on a resonator. I mean, you've heard this kind of sound before. I mean, it's on a lot of the records, and you know, Ry Cooder used it. And this particular one, the Style 4, is probably the most.
It's the most desirable. And by the way, they made a round neck, which you play like a regular guitar. They made a square neck, which you play on your lap with a slot. So they made two versions.
Right. Some nights I feel like I'm playing a square neck, even though I have a round neck. The next slide is a bass. And now you have to, before we even get into the electric bass, you have to acknowledge the contributions to both amplification and modern electric instruments by the man known as Leo Fender.
Yes.
And Leo's greatest invention, in my opinion, would have to be the amplifier. The way he wired it We still use the same circuits today. Matter of fact, my main amplifier is a 1959. Every Marshall amp that you see on stage is derivative of a Fender Bassman made in 1958. Leo was a genius, and he also came up with a way to amplify bass and electrify bass that hadn't been done before with the precision bass.
Right, and it was, his business really was a radio business to start with. And then he realized that a lot of these groups needed amplification. And a lot of these guys that prior to be playing these Fender basses, they were playing the upright basses, which were big and funky to take around. And if they didn't have the proper pickups, they really, you know, you had trouble, you know, being heard, and the pickups would make noise if they had a pickup on it, or with a microphone, you'd have to place it right in front of the microphone. So these instruments, you could actually play at a high volume and be heard. Plus, you can solo, you can do a lot of things there, and it's a fretted instrument, so you have guides as to where you're going.
So imagine, like, and we still use, in modern music, the bass really hasn't changed much from these original precision-based designs, the electric bass. And it's the equivalent of, like, let's just say you were driving the same style car in 1952, and in 2016, the same style and engineering that went into that car is basically unchanged for almost 60 years. I mean, it's incredible how we still use these instruments that were made and invented probably within an 8 to 10 year period.
There was a kind of a golden age of instrument making for the acoustic guitars, like the early 30s to actually like the mid 60s, and then for the electric guitars, the actual golden age was the late 50s, because the designs became perfected. And they were able to be used in modern setting.
Kind of like this guitar here, the 1959 Gibson ES-355. Now, you know this is the Chuck Berry guitar. You know this is the B.B. King guitar.
Otis Rush.
Otis Rush.
Little Milton.
Larry Carlton. And a guy that doesn't get enough credit, there's two guys that don't get enough credit. One would be Ted McCarty, who was a designer at Gibson.
Yeah, he was really instrumental in making a lot of these instruments that they've never improved upon, really. I mean, these companies have research and development, but they already researched and developed everything they needed to do. So, you know, everything that they're doing now is sort of a variation on the same theme that they came up with.
Exactly, like Seth Lover built the pickups, invented the humbucking pickup. And if you notice this little Bigsby tailpiece right at the bottom, right there. A guy named Paul Bigsby, who doesn't get enough credit as a guitar designer, that was his tremolo piece, but he was a brilliant designer of guitars and pickups and steels, and he was a guy that was kind of forgotten other than for, you know, a tremolo or you know, just in name, but he was a great inventor.
And last night I was watching Johnny A, and he's got a Bigsby on his guitar, and he knows how to use it, guys. You better catch him the next time he's playing.
So, sometimes my girlfriend will tell you, we'll be watching a movie, and like, immediately I begin yelling at the television. Why? Because if there's ever a band playing, and it's supposed to be the 1950s or the 1960s, and somebody's up there with some fucking reissue, I start yelling at the TV. Now, am I Elvis Presley? Do I shoot the television? No, I do not. But I do stand up in righteous indignation going, can I get in touch with the continuity person and have a conversation? It's not that hard. One of the biggest continuity anomalies in history is a movie that you know very well. We can go to the next slide. Now, nope, there you go. You see Michael J. Fox in Back to the Future. What year did they go back?
1955.
1955. And what is Michael J. Fox playing? By the way, a guitar that was loaned to the movie studio by Norm. They requested this guitar even though...
Well, originally they came to me and they said, we're doing a movie in, you know, set in 1955, and we'd like things to be accurate, and we want a guitar that looks futuristic for its time. So I actually suggested this Gibson ES-5. It was a thick body jazz guitar with three pickups, and it was pretty futuristic for that time. So the prop director from the movie said, that'll be fine. I said, listen, the guitar's like $1,500. This was, you know, whatever year that was at the time of the movie. And the prop director said, well, we'll just rent it for $300 a week. I said, you know, you probably should just buy it. You know, he said, nah, don't worry about it. You know, we'll just rent it for $300 a week. So I said, fine. So they kept the guitar for 10 weeks, never even opened the case. Then the day that they were going to film the guitar, the art director came in and he went, oh, no, no, that's not going to do. We need a red guitar with a whammy bar. So they came to me and I said, well, that didn't even exist in 55. We're going to have to kind of, you know, there are a couple of Gretsch models, there's, you know, some stuff, but not what you're looking for. And he saw this ES-345 and I said, listen, I've got to warn you, this guitar is not historically accurate. They said, well, we're going to take artistic liberty. So I said, fine. So they kept that guitar for about 6 or 8 weeks. Again, $300 a week, and I said to the prop guy, this is crazy, why don't you just buy the guitar? And they said, this is the movies, don't worry about it, they can afford it. So that guitar they used in the movie, and then they had to re-rent it again to get some close-up shots. And then when they went to Back to the Future 2, they had to duplicate it again. So I was happy to rent them the guitar.
So Norm, tell the fine folks here, some of the movies you've been involved with supplying instruments for that they would know.
Well, there's been hundreds of them, you know, Why the Fools Fall in Love, The Temptation Story, I mean, just on and on, For the Boys with Bette Midler, where they needed instruments from certain time periods. But actually, the first one to really try to be historically correct was David Carradine in Bound for Glory. It was a Woody Guthrie story. And they wanted all these instruments from the Dust Bowl era, and they wanted them, at the time, there weren't really reissues, and they really got it completely correct, except for one guitar. I don't know why, but at the very end, after getting every little detail, we just went crazy, just braining out on trying to find every little thing to make it correct. And then he pulls out this Mossman guitar that was completely incorrect for the time period. And, you know, it was David Carradine, so I never really got the answer exactly why. And David was a strange dude. I mean, I love David, but he was out. And just one little side note, he came into the store one day, and he's got this huge bottle, like a, you know, one of those water bottles that would go on top of a cooler, you know, the Sparklets or Arrowhead or whatever they have in your area. And he brings it in, and there's all this dirt in the bottle, and there's like twigs and, you know, bugs and a dead snake in this bottle. And I said, you know, what's this for? He goes, don't worry, you know. And, you know, he brought it up to me, and the smell of it was just like, you know, I just couldn't even get near it. And he just takes a big swig out of it, and it was like some kind of Chinese, you know, whatever. So he was a strange character, but he would come in the store and he had this giant dog who would occasionally pee on amplifiers and, you know, but...
Always nice to see you. Not always nice to see you, David. One of the movies that I think the folks would know would be Spinal Tap. And a great vintage guitar movie, also a great movie in rock and roll. I remember being on a tour in 2003, and it was the first time we ponied up and rented a tour bus. And we went out, and when I tell you, the shows weren't selling, folks. We were playing for the door, and they weren't selling, and we kind of ran out of steam, and the tour was just going really flat and bad. And I remember being on the bus, and we put on Spinal Tap, and we were watching it, and not... It was the only time I didn't laugh at the movie because their tour was going better than mine.
just to fill you in, right at the front of the Holiday Inn, it said puppet show and Spinal Tap.
Yes. And then, of course, the last waltz with the band. So you supplied instruments for Robbie Robertson.
If you haven't seen that movie, that is the greatest rock documentary of all time. Unbelievable. And Robbie actually was really instrumental in building my business. You know, he was, I used to run an ad in the LA Times, and he came over and he came to my apartment and he bought some guitars for me. I had guitars all over my apartment. And the next week he said, would you mind if I brought a friend? I said, no problem. And he brought Bob Dylan. The following week he brought Joni Mitchell and Robin Ford. And through like word of mouth, these people kept telling their friends, because there was nobody back then who kind of specialized in older instruments. So they were telling their friends, and that's, it kind of forced me to open a store, because I was just buying and selling out of my little apartment.
And then, you know, this guy drops by.
Yeah. He was the first really big star that I ever dealt with. He had this red Les Paul here that was given to him by Eric Clapton.
Yes.
And the guitar was stolen from him, and it was sold in a store in Hollywood. And they were able to get in touch with the person who had bought the guitar. He was a guy who was a Mexican-American, lived part of the year in Mexico and part of the year in America. They contacted him and said, you know, the guitar you bought was George Harrison's guitar. He'd like to have it back. And the guy said, well, you know, listen, I'm happy to give him back his guitar, but I did buy a late 50s Les Paul and I would like one in exchange. So they happened to go to a friend of mine's music store. This is way before I had a store. And he said, well, there's only one guy I know who's got some of these guitars, and I had like three or four at the time. So my friend, his name was Dale Rossman, who's the guy in the middle there, he called me up and said, listen, I've got a very important person who wants to buy some of this Les Paul. And this was like early in the morning. And I said, okay. And he said, well, I need you to come over here right now. And I said, well, you know, I just got out of bed. And, you know, he said, no, you really need to come over. I said, Del, you know, what's the deal? He said, it's George Harrison. So I jumped in my car and I went to his store. And I walk in and it's just my friend Dale. And I said, okay, you know, were you pulling my leg? What's going on? He said, no, George is getting a slice of pizza next door, you know. And he walks in with Mal Evans, who was the Beatles road manager. And I ended up taking him back to my apartment in Sherman Oaks. And my wife Marlene, who's with us, I've been married to her for 45 years. She's put up all this nonsense. She's there still in her bathrobe. You know, I said, George Harrison's coming in. Oh, and by the way, we come in from this underground parking lot and we're coming up to the apartment and a few people see George Harrison. And like, you know, you have to understand, this is about 1971. The Beatles, if you had the president of every country, you had Nelson Mandela, you had Jay-Z, you had every star that you could think of combined, it was nothing like the Beatles. So George and Mal came in, they bought two guitars, one to trade to get this guitar back, and he wanted this guitar. And so he bought that as well. And
what is that guitar, by the way?
That is a 1960 Sunburst Les Paul that I sold it to him for $1,500, which is now probably, forgetting George Harrison, is probably worth $300,000. So then he bought this 56 Stratocaster that was on the couch here too. I don't know if you can see that, for $650, which is probably worth $50,000,
$60,000.
Yes. And he made me throw in a Princeton amp, which I was happy to do. He drove a hard bargain. So
anyway, he was a little strapped for cash at the time.
He kind of made me feel bad for it. So we make the deal, we're walking out of the apartment, all of a sudden now there's like 100 people standing outside the apartment. You know, this is George Harrison, you know, I mean, the biggest star in the world just about. So we end up making the deal. I actually went to, he had a place in the Hollywood Hills, and Ravi Shankar was staying there, and I spent a couple of days with him, and every time that I kept looking at him, it was like, you know, I couldn't believe that it was really him, you know. I mean, I think he was afraid I was going to probably kidnap him or something. And at the very end, this one little addendum, this lady comes to me just maybe about a year ago, and she said, came to my store and said, you know, I lived in that apartment building when you sold George Harrison those guitars. And she said, you know, I remember everybody was going crazy, and I still live there with my sister and my mom. And my sister's Paula Abdi. So you never know in LA who might be living next door.
So this next slide kind of brings full circle what I play and why people like George Harrison ring up Norm in the morning looking for late 50s, early 1960 Les Paul standards. And now this photo here is, you know, thank you for being modest, Norman, but you know, this isn't a $1 million photo, if not more.
Yeah, well, it's also a testimony to some of the stupidest things that I didn't buy as well. There's a few that were offered to me, just didn't have the foresight to buy, and by the time I came back around, they were gone.
So these are the guitars that I play live now. So this one is what we call Spot. And I've had this for about 5 years, and it's a 59 Les Paul. And the double white coils, basically it's just what's underneath the chrome covers. You know, some of them had two black coils, some of them had one white coil, one black coil, they call that a zebra. These are the double creams, which a guy named Larry DiMarzio now owns the patent on them, so it's, you know, don't clap, it's a pain in the ass. Steve Larry makes everybody's life harder. This guitar I play live, and you know, it's been played. Obviously, it's not mint condition. I have a few at home that are mint, and you know, the thing about when I started basically spending all my money on these, and people think I'm a very wealthy person, which I'm not. I'm actually just a guitar addict with a credit card. And I said to myself, well, I'm gonna go out and play them. I love them. It's what I wanna make music on. And the very first one I bought, a cheeky fellow, let's just say, came up to me and said, I had paid $165,000 for a guitar. And I said, it was more than all the money I had in the world. I was in debt, I was in hock, I pawned my shoelaces, that's why I wear Vans. And I said, and the guy comes to me and goes, you know, every scratch you put on the guitar takes $1,000 off the value. And I said to myself, well, if I scratch it 165 times, is it worthless? And then I said, no. So then I just put it on, and I played, and we took it to the Beacon Theater, and I've taken them to the Albert Hall, and I've taken them all around the world. And I'm safe to assume that this is the only 59 Les Paul in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico at the moment. So what I'd like, what I thought I'd do, because you'd probably be like, well, maybe I'll play a little for you, is kind of show you some of the riffs that were made famous by these type of guitars, you know, starting... Hold on, sorry. By the way, I have the amp behind the curtain because it's like so loud. Anyway. So basically... So that's like the first time you've ever heard a real 59 Les Paul when you hear Zeppelin, you know, or you hear Fleetwood Mac. Getting drunk on slow gin, eating Fritos, and playing through a tweet amp, you know? But
he's easily amused.
Yeah, exactly. But yo, the story behind these guitars is the flame top, and by the late 50s, 58, 59, and 1960, the Les Paul model was pretty much almost endangered. They weren't selling as many. These were not hits at the time. You would think they would have sold a million of them. They didn't. They sold about 1,700 over the 3 years. And then they discontinued what you would now call Les Paul and turned it into what you now call an SG, but still with the Les Paul name, only for 1 year. And then there was about a decade where they didn't make a Les Paul anything. Until Jimmy Page, until George Harrison, until Eric Clapton, until Jeff Beck, you know.
Mike Bloomfield,
you know. Everybody started calling dealers, and Norm, you know, in particular, looking for late 50s Les Pauls. And all of a sudden, the guitar that retailed for $265 with the case now became $1,500. Then it became, by 1980, how much were they worth?
By 1980, probably about 5,000, maybe something like that.
By 1990?
About 50,000.
2,000?
100,000.
What's the most you've ever heard one selling for?
$500,000.
Yeah. And that's, there you go. And the guitar itself, they're pretty much what I would, the electric version of Stradivarius violins. Now you'd say, well, maybe one day the music made on these guitars isn't popular. You could say the same, that classical music isn't exactly, you know, up there with the most popular music now, but people still appreciate grand old things with handcrafted, you know, I mean, it's just the wood and the materials and everything that went into it. And the other cool thing about all this stuff we've talked about is every screw, fret, piece of plastic, knob, tuning machine, fretboard inlay, everything was made in America.
And one other thing I like to say is, I like to call it functional art, because, you know, you could buy a baseball card for more than the most expensive guitar. Same thing with a stamp, a coin, and you can stare at it for a few minutes and then put it away. This thing is made to play music, and it has its own individual sound, and these guitars, every one of them, because they were handmade, have their own fingerprint. So they're all individual. Now everything is CNC, which are these computerized machines that make things. It's good for consistency, but it's not for individuality.
Well, you know, and the thing is, what we've talked about is the highest end of guitar collectible state. And the thing about it is, as a guitar player, all of your sound, right here, and these are tools, this is a tool, everything is a tool. Yes, they're beautiful instruments, they're collected, highly sought after. This is a
Joe Bonamassa
Gibson Epiphone Les Paul, which we are raffling off. And we got everybody to sign it. Some people have nicer signatures than others. I can see Robert Randolph has a very nice signature. So we got everybody to sign it, and somebody's going to walk off the boat with this. But again, 59 Les Paul, a brand new
Joe Bonamassa
from Les Paul. I've seen kids take a $300 guitar and absolutely kill it. I've also seen grown men
take a $500,000
guitar and kill the crowd, not in a good way. So that's the lesson in all that. Let's go to the next slide. Finally, yes, the story of Amos. I did this tour last summer called The Three Kings. And I've never seen it. We paid tribute to Freddie King, Albert King, and unfortunately the late great B.B. King, who wasn't alive to see it. We missed it. One of the big regrets about the whole tour is that he died in May and the tour is in August. I would have just loved to have seen his reaction to me playing his songs after 25 years. I think he would have been proud of what we did. I hope we did him proud. So anyway. So I went to Norman after the tour and he saw me play at the Greek Theater and I said, Norman, I know I said I'd never do this, but I want a flying V like Albert King played. And I went to Norman two reasons. One, I knew he had one, and most importantly, it is real. And the thing about any collectibles you see, it could be on Antiques Roadshow, or you could be anywhere, where there's something of value, there are fakes. And the only person in the world I trust to have everything real, Norm Harris. That's why he's here. And that's why he spends his time. And that's why
I'm very, very sorry.
So, I went to Norman, I knew he had a V, and he had it. How long have you had that V?
I had it for 35 years.
Yeah. And so I got together, I went to Sparklets, I got a giant water jug. And I put a snake in there, some drinks, some Earl Grey tea, and about 10,000 pennies. And I drove it up the 101 North to Van Nuys, and I said, Norman, I got these 10,000 pennies. Can I pay you penny for penny? He was nice enough to sell me the guitar on time. And when I got it home, I texted a picture of the serial number to my guitar tech, Mike Hickey, and within 20 minutes,
he sends me a picture of that guy.
Now, 2 years before, I had that guy as my screensaver, because remember,
we got a nerd.
And this music store called Arthur's Music in Indianapolis, Indiana, has been open since 1952. It is the longest family-owned music store in the United States. So kudos to them for keeping it going. Amy and Linda had found the scrapbook and they were posting these on Facebook. Now there's the Flying V in the store, there's Amos Arthur, and there's Kenny C, their guitar instructor, with the guitar. Now that pole is kind of cut off, but there's a woman about 100 feet off the ground setting a Guinness Book of World Record for a pole sitting event, which was, again, the style at the time. I mean, hey, you know, I got nothing to do for the next 400 fucking days. Let me sit on top of the pole. Anyway, the serial number of the V Norman sold me matches the logs of the serial number that was shipped to Arthur's Music. And it turned out our V that we're talking about is that V. You can go to the other side. So there I am. So on the left, there I am, on a lovely American flight from Los Angeles to Indianapolis. And there's Amos Arthur. Or Amos, as I call it. In its case, seat 1A.
Between you and me?
You know, all the psychiatrists in Florida couldn't help this man.
So, when we flew to Indianapolis, now, something that rare and that precious, you do not check it into baggage, no thank you. And I'm sitting at the gate with it, and it's a full flight, and I'm with my friend Rick Gould, and this woman, she's in the middle of doing everything. She's like a human Ganesha. She has actually 4 or 5 arms, like, just doing things. And I just kind of waddle up to the gate and just sit there, and she sees the guitar, and she stops what she's doing, and she's like... And she goes behind the counter, grabs one of those pink
Bag tag?
I'm competing in the world championship of poker, and I go, can I help you? And she goes, we'd be happy to check that baggage for you for free, sir. And I just go, and I go, and I fan it out like I'm Wyatt fucking Earp, okay? I go, I have two seats. So there I am. And we took it back to Arthur's Music to visit with Amy and Linda. Amos Arthur passed about 10 years ago, and we took it back, and they had not seen the guitar in that shop for 56 years. And it was a really emotional event for them, and it was something that just out of the goodness of our heart, it was great. But I had to get on the roof. So there I am. And so that's the story. So Norman, thank you very much. That guitar will be with me until I can't play, or until whatever, until I pass on. I cannot thank you enough for selling me that guitar, because it really has changed my life, and it's such a great story, and it's so nice to see it. It meant so much to that family that it was unearthed. And after such a long time, because they had heard it was broken and thrown in the trash, or Eric Clapton owned it. So I guess they were happy that it wasn't broken. I've read part of the book, and it's a great read. And it's not just for collectors and uber nerds like myself. The story and the passion that you've put into your business over the last 40 years is inspirational, not only to myself, but everybody in this room. So thank you very much.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. I'd like to say one thing. Did you guys have a great time on this cruise or what? I'm 67 years old, and it's one of the best times I've ever had in my life. What a great cast this man has assembled. And let me just tell you, nothing went by accident. This guy's up there in the production room, every detail, he's on top of it all. So what you're seeing is his work. One of the hardest working guys I've ever had.
My manager, Roy Wiseman, sixth man for putting it all on.
And, what a great crew.
And again, all the great artists that showed up. I mean, I just look around and I see all the great acts, and I'm like, I'm so honored they're here for this, and I can't thank them enough, and I personally can't thank you guys enough for coming out, because if you guys didn't come out, we'd be sitting around in our houses talking about guitars. I mean, it's amazing. Going, man, I wish I had a cruise. Kid Rock gets a cruise, but not me. Anyway, we have a little bit of time, maybe for two or three questions. Does anybody have any questions? You know, I gotta tell you, I'm the luckiest guy in the world, and I'll tell you why. Because every day I wake up, I love the guitar. What you see is what you get with me. I'm no different here than I am on stage. The only reason why I wear sunglasses on stage is because I don't like the spotlight. It really affects my eyes. Some people judge that as arrogance or being up my own ass or something like that. This is what I just read on the internet, by the way. It's fantastic. And truth be told, you guys put me in this chair. That's it. There's so many great guitar players, there's so many great artists that don't get...
Not like you!
But I always say, the fans put me here, and they can also take it away if you do start believing what you read. And that's what keeps me grounded. That's what keeps me motivated. I make records for you guys. I don't make them for Rolling Stone magazine. I put on concerts with long guitar solos because I know that's what you guys like. Not for some reviewer who gets in for free, says I'm overindulgent. I do it for you guys. I
love that.
And I've kept that motto for 25 years. And I'll do it for another 25 until I'm 62, and then I'm going surfing.
Keep going.
All right, we got another question.
Come down.
How was it to do the Les Paul 100 years?
It was great. I would have liked to have a little bit more chance to jam with people like Warren Haynes and Steve Miller, but it was really a great thing. Go ahead, sir. You with the red shirt. Yeah, you got the mic.
Hey, I got a question from Norman. Joe, I've been following you since Miss O'Barr in Atlanta. But Norman, there was, and I'm a guitar addict. My wife's here. I told her never sell them for what I told her.
Thank goodness.
I've got an old Electra. Beautiful guitar. If you sit it down, it looks like a violin, bowed from the back to the front. But there's not a lot of history that I can find on it, other than they were sued by Gibson for copyright. It's got built-in effects, a phase, and a flanger, and it's a fun guitar, but I just can't find a lot of history about it. Can you tell us anything about it?
Well, they're not a super valuable guitar, but they do play and sound really good. And, you know, if you have a good example, that's a guitar that's gig-worthy. And, you know, again, everything is supply and demand, and most people don't know what an Electra is the big problem, you know, and everything is based on marketing. So when people know something about something, that's what creates the value going up. So there's a lot of really cool stuff out there that probably is a sleeper. And you might want to just hang on to it if you like the way it plays.
Yeah.
Could be something that becomes valuable. And a lot of times, if a guy like this guy starts playing one, then everybody wants one.
I want $400 at the roulette table. I'll give you $350 for it right now. We got time for one more question, then Mark Massaro's got to go up here. You, sir, right there in the middle.
Joe, first off, I
want to
thank Mom and Dad for supporting
you. Yeah, thanks, Mom. Thanks, Dad.
Well, thanks, Mom. Secondly, a guitar nerd forever. Every time I see one, my wife is asking me, do you really need another one, first of all?
Yes!
Just one more.
Yeah, just one more, until the next one comes up. But in 1976, I bought a Les Paul at the Guitar Center in San Francisco. I paid $800 for it at the time. Is it worth anything today?
A lot more than you paid.
Okay.
I guarantee you that. I'm not sure I need more information as to what it is.
It's a natural top standard.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Probably three or four times.
Good.
I want $400 at the roulette table. I'll give you $350 cash for
it. You just said good.
If you sign my fingers.
Hey, thank you very much, guys. Enjoy Mark Massaro's coming up next. Thank you, Norman. Thank you, folks.